Little Rock 9, Desegregation of a Nation, by Riley Hinson. In a key event in the civil rights movement, 9 African-American students labeled as a Little Rock 9 attempted to enroll in an all-white school in Little Rock, Arkansas. This was a turning point that would stay in the minds of Americans for years to come. This landmark in history would test the Brown v. Board of Education case of 1954 that mandated all of the country's schools be integrated. With this came very violent riots and mobs which forced President Eisenhower to intervene. They had no idea what they were walking into when they took those first steps up to Central High School. Brown v. Board of Education was a landmark United States Supreme Court case in which laws declaring separate public schools for black and white students were declared unconstitutional. This ruling paved the way for integration and was a major victory of the civil rights movement. But many towns and cities disobeyed this and would keep their schools segregated, including Little Rock, Arkansas's Central High School. Superintendent Virgil Blossom shaped the integration plan that started in the older grades and advanced to the lower grades. By 1957, the city of Little Rock would have 4 high schools, Horace Mann High, which was intended for black students, along with Hall, Central, and Little Rock Technical High Schools, which were white-only schools. Blossom and the school board decided to start integration by admitting a few black students to Central High for the 1957-58 school year. Daisy Bates, a local newspaper woman, helped organize 33 black students of various ages who wanted to attend several all-white schools in Little Rock. The principals of all the schools refused to enroll the students, telling their families to discuss the matter with Mr. Blossom. The superintendent remained firm, saying they would stick to the plan of gradual integration. Daisy Bates then resorted to a court case. It was ruled that it was reasonable to begin integrating Little Rock schools in September 1957. In the summer of 1957, the principals of the city's black junior and senior high schools sent a compiled list of pupils wanting to enroll at all-white Central High School to Mr. Blossom. After the superintendent convinced many of them that Central High wasn't right for them, 10 children were left wanting to enroll. But because of the tense events, one more dropped out, leaving 9 students named the Little Rock 9. On the night of September 2nd, Governor Orval Faubus ordered 300 Arkansas National Guardsmen to surround Central High School. He claimed that they will not act as segregationists or integrationists, but as soldiers there to keep the peace. He then revealed which side he had taken. He said, "It is my opinion that it will not be possible to restore or to maintain order and protect the lives and property of the citizens if forcible integration is carried out tomorrow. The schools for the time being must be operated on the same basis as they have in the past." In other words, for an unspecified period, the 9 black students must stay out of Central High. The African American students attempted to start school on September 4th. Daisy and her husband, Elsie Bates, got in their car that morning and began to drive to where she was meeting the students. She switched on the radio and heard a news bulletin about an African American girl being mobbed at Central High. Daisy cried in horror because she had forgotten to inform Elizabeth Eckford that they were driving to Central together. Meanwhile, Elizabeth Eckford, unaware of the plan, had taken a bus to school. She stepped off the bus to find a line of armed guardsmen and a crowd of some 400 white people. At first, she was glad to see the National Guardsmen and assumed they were there to protect her. But when she tried to enter the school, they blocked her path, even raising their bayonet. The crowd of white segregationists closed in on Elizabeth. Not knowing what else to do, she walked to a nearby bus stop and sat down and cried. She later recalled, "I tried to see a friendly face somewhere in the mob, someone who would maybe help. I looked into a face of an old woman, but when I looked at her again, she spat on me." Moments later, with the crowd of people still screaming names and insults at Elizabeth, she boarded a bus, leaving the ugly mob behind. Meanwhile, the 8 other African-American students and a few ministers were walking to Central High School. As the students approached, the mob closed in on them. When the students tried to enter the school, the troops ordered them to halt. One of the reverends asked the guardsmen if they were preventing the children from entering the school, which he replied yes, from the orders of the governor. Later that day, Mrs. Bates took the students to the Little Rock office of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, and the students told them about what had happened that morning. By now, it was apparent that Governor Faubus had stationed the National Guard to keep the black students out. Soon the whole nation knew what had happened. With the National Guardsmen surrounding the school, the Little Rock 9 still couldn't enter. The President of the United States, Dwight D. Eisenhower, exchanged telegrams with Governor Faubus. the president was furious at the Arkansas governor's action. He had turned the phrase "with liberty and justice for all," recited by millions of American schoolchildren each morning, into hollow words. He had helped to convince people around the world who were watching the events unfold in Little Rock that Americans were opinionated and cruel. The president tried to convince the Arkansas governor to change his mind and admit the black students. Hobbs proposed that the integration of Little Rock schools must be delayed for a year-long cooling-off period. President Eisenhower denied the proposal. The Arkansas Supreme Court held a hearing on the school crisis and ordered Governor Faubus to stop interfering with the integration of Central High. Realizing that he may be put in jail if he kept this up, Governor Faubus removed the Arkansas National Guard from Central High School. On Monday, September 23, 1957, the 9 students set off for the high school. They entered through the back door of the school to try to avoid the violent mob. The mob became very overwhelming. They chased and beat black reporters who were covering the event. The Little Rock police, fearful that they could not control the increasingly unruly mob, removed the Little Rock 9 later that morning. Calling the mob's actions disgraceful, President Eisenhower called out 1,200 members of the 101st Airborne Division. On September 25, 1957, under federal troop escort, the 9 returned to Central High School for their first full day of classes. At school, the Little Rock 9 suffered repeated harassment, such as kicking, shoving, and name-calling. The harassment went as far as stabbing, and some white students threatened to throw acid in Melba Batillo's eyes. After the various tormenting, the military guards were assigned to each one of the Little Rock 9. The guards, however, could not protect them everywhere, and harassment continued in the restrooms and locker rooms. After the soldiers left in November, leaving the National Guard troops in charge, segregationist students intensified their efforts to compel the 9 to leave Central. Nevertheless, they returned to school every day so they could receive equal education. Although all of the 9 endured verbal and physical abuse during their year at Central, Minnie Jean Brown was the only one to respond. She was first suspended and then expelled for retaliating against the daily torment by dropping her lunch tray with a bowl of chili on 2 white boys, and later by referring to a girl who hit her as white trash. Of her experience, she later said, "I just can't take everything they throw at me without fighting back." Minnie Jean moved to New York City and graduated from New Lincoln High School in 1959. The other 8 students remained at Central High until the end of the school year. On May 27, 1958, Ernest Green became Central High School's first black graduate. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. attended his graduation ceremony. The next year at Central is now referred to as the Lost Year. Several important events happened over the summer of 1958. The Little Rock School Board requested from the federal court system a delay in further implementing desegregation. The district judge granted the request but was overturned and then affirmed by the U.S. Supreme Court in Cooper v. Aaron. Then, on August 26, 1958, Governor Faubus had a series of laws passed to forestall desegregation. Among the bills was Act 4, which allowed the closure of any school threatened with racial integration. The Supreme Court met in special session in September 1958 and ordered the immediate integration of Central High School. Governor Faubus took advantage of Act 4 from the bills that were passed. He closed all 4 high schools in Little Rock beginning on Monday, September 15th, interrupting the education of nearly 4,000 students, black and white. Voters in Little Rock, after a year of closed public schools, were finally willing to accept limited desegregation. All 4 high schools opened again on August 12, 1959. Integration in Little Rock continued slowly until federal courts encouraged the use of busing to fully integrate all public schools in the nation. The Little Rock 9's accomplishments were an immense turning point. If it weren't for the 9 African American students that enrolled at a once all-white school, most of our country schools today could still be segregated. They will stay in the hearts and minds of people all around the world for years to come.